night. All right, I just want you to know nothing I said last night was true. So that I can be unconstrained about what I say today. All right, do me a favor. No, just with your long photo lens, go way far away so I'm not doing a photo shoot. Okay? All right, so let me just tell you a few things about what I've been doing of late, and during which time you can come up with some questions that you would like to ask. And there is a, it's really hard for me to see. There is a, do me a favor, turn the lights down just a little bit, but I can't see anybody. There's a mic that you can come up. Is this the mic here? Great. Oh, that was helpful. Is this the mic right here? Yes?
Yeah.
Why don't you put it in the center of the room so that people can, you know, or put another one up there. All right, during that time, I just finished a play called Mr. Wolf. And Mr. Wolf was written by Rajiv Joseph, and he is one of America's great up-and-coming playwrights. He wrote The Bengal Tiger and the Baghdad Zoo. Actually, that's put it in the center of the room. That way they don't have to walk too far. And it was a very unusual play because I played an astronomer who I have a very close relationship with a 15-year-old. It's a very, very intense play. There will be rewrites as it develops and what have you. But it was, for me, it was an opportunity to go back to the boards. Let's see, what else? Oh, I'm a sailor, so I sailed my own boat from California to the Marquesas, to the Tuamotos, to the Society Islands, which are Tahiti and Morea and Raiatea and what have you. And then I sailed back, which was about a 51-day venture at sea with some adventures in that period of time. What else? If this were a Star Trek crowd, you would already know my family situation. But I have two sons, and one of them is in Vancouver and works in an architecture firm, and the other one works in the State Department, is a diplomat in the State Department. So, with that said, no, there are a few more things. So, get your questions going. You should just start coming up for questions if you have any.
Wow.
That's why we need a couple of mics. Okay? You get a couple of
I don't do questions and then.
Oh, wow.
Okay?
Holy crap.
Oh, they're going to get on it. That's right. I've been asked to be involved in a lot of video games, and I know you guys play a fair amount of video games.
Yeah.
I just finished StarCraft. I'm getting ready to do a game which I can't quite tell you about totally yet, but I'm going to Boston. I'm going to be very involved in a Star Trek game. How many of you know the character? This is not a game, though. How many of you know the character of Brainiac? So now, oh my God, look at all the people in our desk.
You're in for it.
And I love the little girl who's the first up. She turned around. She looked.
I'm a boy.
Oh. Hey.
All right, what's your first question?
If Discord had a cutie mark, what do you think it would be?
Well,
something
maybe
to do with chaos.
It would be like the tattoo that I have.
Oh.
was one that was a something I had dreamt of since I was 12 years old. I went to the same islands that Melville went to, that Robert Louis Stevenson went to, and on the beach in Iwa, I had a guy with a piece of bamboo and another piece of shark's tooth give me a tattoo. And when I came home, and you know, I've been gone for 4 months, when I came home, my wife said, "Oh my God, I'm going to bed with a gang member." Okay, next.
What's your favorite part about, first of all, Ironborn? First of all, I just want you to know that first that I am a boy. What's your favorite part about playing Discord?
Oh, you know what? At first it was a job about doing something that was well written. I didn't really know about it. I didn't know about the show. So, but I knew that the script was very good, and I like doing, you know, good work on scripts. It actually makes it easier to do good work. But then, when all of this happened, I realized that it was bigger than just Discord or bigger than the script. It was the beginning of another community that was forming. So to be part of that became really important to me. And that was probably the reason in which I went ahead and produced that that documentary. So now the best part is that it's being here.
Awesome.
Okay, next.
Why did you decide to become the voice actor for Discord?
Well, I didn't decide to become the voice actor for Discord. I simply got a call. And the call was from my agent saying, "You have an offer." Now, what happened is that the person who created My Little Pony, Friendship is Magic, her name is Lauren Faust. And when she was creating the character of Discord, in her attempts to explain this character to the people who were, you know, I guess from Hasbro and in other words, the suits, she gave her explanation. "Well, you know, he's sort of a chameleon. He's got many different parts. He's chaotic, and you know," and they were like, "No, I don't know." And then she said, "Well, he's like Q on Star Trek." And they went, "Oh my God." "Could we get John DeLancey?" So she said, "Well, we can try." So they and in our business, what you do is that they call, you know, they find out who represents John DeLancey, and they call my voiceover agent. And he called me, and I said, "Let me read the script." So I read the script, and I went, "Yeah, this is a really nice script, so I'll do it." Woo!
Hi there. My name is Genevieve, and I was curious, what was your favorite episode that you played in?
I didn't quite hear that.
What was your favorite episode that you've ever been in?
Of
My Little Pony.
Of course. What was my favorite episode? Well, you know what? I really liked the last episode that I just did.
Yeah. Woo!
Yeah! I was taken by that story when I first read it. And then it takes me 2 or 3 hours to prep it, and then a couple of hours to record it, which I did the next day. And all during that period of time, I was thinking, what an appropriate story this is, because you might think at your age that you're the only one who gets hurt by the fact that your friend, who you thought was your friend, has another friend. But people my age have that issue too. So it's really wonderful to be involved in a story, that particular story, that episode, which actually talks about that. And so that's yet another reason why it's fun to be on a show that is actually dealing with big ideas. These are big human ideas. And it's wonderful that you get to watch them in a way that's sort of, you know, colorful. It's you know, it's all those type of things. It's entertaining, but it's also an important issue. So that's the one. Okay, next.
Thank you very much.
My question is, since you were playing Q in Star Trek and Discord, what are the similarities in both of those characters?
Well, the obvious similarity is that I'm playing it. I have played, it seems to be part of my character, even as a kid, to always play or have sort of the naughty boy
trolling
take on things. So it didn't come as a surprise. Actually, you know what came as a surprise? Is that after I did that first episode of My Little Pony, it was months later that somebody said to me, "Oh, well, that's Q." I went, "No, it's Discord." And then when Lauren said to me, "Oh, no, I actually hired you because you played Q." I was like, "Really? I don't quite see the similarity." So I had to be brought to it. I don't really think of these things as being just some big continuum. I was on a soap opera years and years and years ago, and I've actually had people say to me, "Oh, so when you went down to the basement to disappear, you actually were disappearing to Star Trek, right?" What? So yeah, there are similarities, but their similarities are really me. I'm the naughty little boy. Okay, next.
Did you ever think you're gonna get as popular as you are now?
popular before.
The answer is no, but mostly in how it's no. I grew up in a very classical world. My father was a classical musician. I went to a private school which was almost exclusively built on the classics. By the time I graduated from high school, I had already done 5 Shakespeares, acted in 5 Shakespeares. I know classical music very, very well. So, and I didn't listen to pop anything. And so for me, my popularity is sort of unusual, and it's still sort of unusual, because it's not a world that I inhabit. I don't really inhabit popular culture, personally. And yet, I have done 3 things, at least, which have huge popular culture, are part of the popular culture scene. So in that respect, it is unusual, and it does surprise me. Okay, next. Why are you clapping? Yes.
In your, like, opinion, what is the best background pony?
Background.
In your opinion, who is the best background pony?
You mean like Fluttershy?
No!
No! No! No!
I'm just fishing. I'm just wondering. I don't know how to answer that other than what I just did. I don't think I could top what I just did. Okay, next.
Do you know who I Love Kim Possible a lot is?
I do now.
Woo, can't be!
I'm gonna ask a question later anyway, but we actually did. I made a video for you, and that's probably what they're all referencing. We'll talk about it later. but we actually did a charity shirt selling thing before the convention, so we have these shirts, and I saved you one. Would you like it?
Sure.
Okay.
Oh, I can't possibly show this. Oh, no, you don't want to see this.
I'm gonna smoke it up.
Me.
Yeah.
Avert your eyes.
Space pirate.
Okay, next. Yes, next. Oh, there's a negotiation that's taking place.
Who's your favorite main six pony?
Oh. Who's my favorite what?
Main six pony.
Pink.
Pink. Who is it?
That's not a main
Droopy?
Six pony. What the hell? Now we're going way off topic.
I think there is a certain level of question that you see, you only get a certain level of response. Don't get too specific with me about this show. All right, next.
Why do you actually like Droopy?
You're killing me. Because we just kind of hang out together. Next!
Who is your least favorite and favorite pony, not counting this
one? Oh my god. Fluttershy, there we go. I think that there need to be some discussions pre-questions to keep them in the generality that I can answer. Okay, with that, what's the next question?
If you could voice any pony else on the show, who would it be?
If I did voice somebody else?
Yes, you.
You know that rock that you the one that they're always galloping past? I would be that. Okay, next. This is a whole new level for me of questions.
Do you know the pony Screwball?
Do I know how they evolve? I think that this is a question you should speak to your parents about.
Do you know the pony Screwball?
Screwball!
Water, man! Yeah!
Oh, no.
No, next.
No. I know, I'm a huge disappointment. Okay. All right. Now, as the, dare I say, adult, or at least taller than the last 10 people, ask me a question I can answer.
Hi, so after you did the first role of Discord, did you feel it was going to be a one-time thing, or would you come back for another role later on?
Oh, okay. How many of you have seen the documentary that we produced? Woo! Nick is here, who knows more about it than, well, maybe Mike might know more than you, but after Mike, it's you. Yeah. So I've asked him to be here to be able to answer questions because, well, why don't you come up? We need another, we need a mic here, okay? So somebody run a mic down here. What was it that when you came, oh great. We were faced with putting together this documentary. And Mike Brockoff, who was the producer, said, you know, I put out some feelers and we need to start staffing the offices. We need people, and mostly we need somebody who knows about this subject. We know how to make a documentary, but we need somebody who can help us. So what was it when, tell them about when you and I first met.
Oh, goodness. On the very first day of work, maybe just a single day after I got the interview, I got an email from my boss saying, I hadn't even met anybody on the crew yet, and I got an email from my boss saying, hey, I need you to drop by John Delancey's house to pick up a flash drive on the way to work for your first day. And I was just like, I wasn't sure what to do, so then I drove to his place after I got the address, that hill in front of your house, by the way. It's intense. He was at the door, and I was just like, the entire time, I was kind of shivering in my boots. And he was talking, you know, he's just talking. He had his feet propped up on the desk, and he's just like, you're going to be the fly on the wall. What was it? He said something along that line.
I said, if you play your card, because Mike had hired you for, I think, like 5 days.
Right.
And I said, you know, if you play your cards right, and if you actually do your work, you will be here for a very long time. Maybe as much as 3 or 4 weeks.
Wow!
How long were you there?
Until this February, which has been 3 years.
3 years. A number of the sequences were edited by this gentleman. He was the one who was saying during the interviews that we were taking, he was going, oh, that's really important, you have to include that. And so he was our prism, or our lens into what at the time was really a very small fandom.
It was growing really fast at that moment, but I don't think any of us really knew how much bigger it was going to get from the time that we started. To go back to that question that you asked, I think John actually specifically got that extra role with the that Twilight episode of Three's a Company or something like that. Three's a Crowd, right. Because they heard him singing in the documentary. I don't think he had any idea that he would ever be on the show again after that, but then he got that.
Right. I mean, you know, a lot of those are, why don't you grab it, because I, so you can, and then we can, that way we can bring the chair out. That way we can go back and forth when it's documentary questions, okay? So you don't have to jump out. I didn't know, but most of the shows in which I've done have been a little bit through the back door. I'm sort of an actor who has been blessed with the ability to understand what is needed. This is a big issue. So this is an important issue in all work. There is what is wanted, and then there's what's needed. Okay? And sometimes, more often than not, you are hired or asked to do something based on what is wanted. But it's your ability to look at the show and look at what it is that's going on and find what is also needed. So I have been always sort of good at that. And I'm always looking for that. So when I did the soap opera, which was many, many years ago, they asked me to come on the show and to be a psychopath. I've played many a psychopath. But what they needed was a comedian, and they didn't know it. So I played a psycho as if he were a comedian. And after 5 days, it was a 5-day gig, which turned into a 3-year gig, based on being able to do that. Same thing with Star Trek. What they wanted was, omnipotent characters, but what they also needed again was something. It had to be an omnipotent being who is too stupid to know it, or an all-powerful being with feet of clay. And so those are the things that I added. In this case, My Little Pony, the added part was I did the show, forgot about it, saw it, and then began to get a lot of feedback from an audience which was completely unexpected. The Brony audience, completely unexected. And Hasbro and all the people in this, in that department, as it were like, oh my God, we make these things for 10-year-old girls. What are we doing with 25-year-old guys? What does that mean? And that's when Mike came to me and he said, we should do a documentary. And I began looking at it and I go, what is needed here is that these guys need cover for a show that is about being nice and good and charitable and honest and what have you, and they're being made fun of. Let's provide that, which then became the added ingredients of what is needed. And so that's how you grow things. That's how you make things develop. Okay, next question. Woo! Okay.
So, seeing the fact that you have played a lot of various characters from live action and animation, my question being, what was it like transitioning from live acting to animation?
Well, I mean, the regular answers are very simple. What you're doing is that you're imagining all of it in your head. You're doing it all with your voice. You don't have the wink and the nod that the audience would see, be it on stage or on film. There's also something else, and that is that as a kid, for those of you who were in that session last night, I grew up learning how to read through reading poetry. And one of the things that that helps to foster are images, ideas, just images. I also, it is the ability to tell stories. And the simplest thing, you know, this is the line. This is really heavy. That's what the line is. This is really heavy. So you know that to be able, and if you were on stage, you would go, this is really heavy, or a little more than that. But on just audio lead, you would have to go, this is really heavy, okay? And so you use that as a tool. And so you can't do that on stage because you go, this is really heavy, would sound like overacting because we would see that. We would see it. We don't have to be at that level. But auditorially, you do. There's a Leonard Nimoy and I directed Leonard in a show. And at the end of the show, I went up to him and I said, did you enjoy yourself? He said, I had a great time. And I said, well, I have an idea. Again, what is wanted, what is needed. I said, I have an idea of something that we could do. And we created a company called Alien Voices, which was totally auditory. It was all auditory work. So if you want to hear science fiction being done by some really skilled actors, go to, I don't know where you get them anymore. Oh yes, I do. Well, I don't know. You'll find them. but in any case, you'll hear more and more of it. And many of us who grew up reading a lot, who grew up in that auditory world, when I was a little boy, I used to spend hours listening to records of spoken word, and I really loved it. The Edward R. Murrow, I Can Hear It Now. Like, I would just listen to those things. So for me, it was it is an opportunity to work in a world that is close to me, and I think that I'm more auditory than I am visual. Okay, next.
So, the Mark Celine in the corner over there wanted me to ask, how did you get your start? Did you get scouted, or did you go in for an audition yourself?
What I did was that when I had, I was a really terrible student, and I had flunked out of two schools, and I flunked a grade, which is really tough. And the problem was that I didn't know how to read. And what they discovered was that I was dyslexic, but this is way before people did anything about it. I went to a school that was sort of for kids like me, and I had a wonderful teacher, and one of the things in which took place was that we would do these projects, and at the end of the year in March, he said, we're going to do Henry V, and Delancey, you're gonna play Hal. And I played it, I read it and learned it with great difficulty, and 2 months later I performed it. And for the first time in my young life, I was, as I said, around 14, I was good at something. So I pursued that, and that's how I did it. And I have to say that I've been particularly fortunate. I have sort of back-assed my way into a lot of things, mostly by my willingness to be risky. I have chosen to take the risk. I'll tell you a story which shows this to be the case. I was going to audition for the Globe Shakespeare. I was maybe about 21 years old, and I was in San Francisco, and I had asked to use a room to be able to work up my audition that day and to practice, and the next day was going to be my audition. And as I went to that room, I noticed a bunch of kids who were my age who were auditioning for somebody in another room. I went into my room, I worked for an hour, that my time was up, and I walked out, and I was going to go home. And when I came back out, all of the kids were gone, and there was an older gentleman sitting at a desk in that room. So I said, are you auditioning people? And he said, yes. And I said, well, I have a really important audition tomorrow, and I'd like to be able to show you to sort of practice. And he said, well, go ahead. So I auditioned. And he said, I see. I'd like you to sing Happy Birthday. And I'd like you to sing it to yourself. And imagine that you're at a party that none of your friends have come to. Your own birthday.
Aww.
I would like you to sing Happy Birthday to a dead dog. Your dead dog.
Aww.
I would like you to sing, you know, something else. So I did that. And I said, okay, but what did you think of my audition? He said, how would you like to come to Juilliard? And I said, well, Juilliard's a music school. He said, well, it's also an acting school. I said, you know, I have a really important audition tomorrow.
Screw that, just go to that.
And we talked back and forth, and he said, well, you know, we might be able to give you a scholarship to come to Juilliard. No, you don't understand. I don't want to go to school. I'm not very good in school. And I have a really important audition. Well, we could also perhaps give you a stipend to live. No. And I said, well, thank you very much, though. Thank you. And I started to leave, and he said, now, how would we ever get in touch with you? And I said, well, I don't know where I'm going to be, but hopefully tomorrow I'm going to get that audition, and I'll be, you know, down in San Diego. But here's my parents' number. About a month later, my father called me, and he said, did you audition for Julia? I said, no. Don't you audition for Juilliard? Oh, well, yes, I guess so. Do you know who you auditioned for? I said, no. John Houseman. Well, it doesn't make much impression in this crowd, but it's like the penultimate theater person. He wants you to come to Juilliard. Well, I don't want to go to school. You know, I'm still auditioning. I'm sure I'm going to get a job. Well, I didn't get a job. So I went to Juilliard. So that's why I'm saying I sort of ass-backed my way into my career. Now, while we have Nick up here, some of you, if you have really specific questions about the documentary, I asked him to come and to be able to answer some of those things. So, go ahead. Next question.
Did any of the staff, including you, ever laugh during your song, A Glass of Water?
I never laugh. Yes, although actually during that song, you have to understand, I'm not a singer. I'm really not a singer. I like to say that people pay me not to sing. So when they had me do that song, it was a big deal for me because my wife had to say to me, no, you have to keep the beat. Oh, is that part of singing a song? I just don't sing. So it was really tough to do for me, but I think it came out pretty well, so I'm happy about that.
Woo!
And if there was any laughter, it might have been at the other end I recorded that live in Los Angeles, but they were listening to it in Vancouver, so who knows, maybe they were laughing. Okay, next.
So, how hard was it to do the first few episodes of being Discord?
How hard was it? Well, it's not hard. It's not hard if you do your homework. And I don't want to sound like a big fuddy-duddy about it, but for me, my eyes do a lot of skipping around and what have you. So I really have to read things and know it. And then I have to circle the words, the operative words. Usually if you do circle words in any sentence, the most important ones are the verb. I had to do my homework. But then once I've done my homework, then the actual recording of it is not hard. I mean, it's done quickly, It's fast, and it's at a very high level, so you're like, like that, because it's just really fast stuff. But it's not hard. It's the part that I love. Okay, next. Yeah.
Let's turn this into a party.
Yeah. Okay, next.
How fun was it being in season 4?
In what?
In season 4 of My Little Pony.
Like maybe the last 2 years or so.
Yeah.
How much fun was it to be in the last 2 years of the show recording for it?
Oh, yes. Well, it was fun. Yeah. I mean, how many have I done?
Three?
Five. How many have been done?
99.
So you can see that it's not something that I do every day or even like one a year.
Yeah.
Okay, next.
Not once every season.
I don't know where
to go. Hello, Johnny.
Oh.
There, guy. Okay. Name Zach S. Chicken Man.
What?
I hear
Zach,
yeah,
Chicken
you're Man. Discord himself, or as I like to call the long goofball. So, John, do you have a Twitter, a Facebook? Because your Twitter, I hear you haven't checked it since 2010.
No, I haven't checked Twitter, and I just stopped using Facebook,
yeah,
mostly because everybody was wanting me to be their friend, telling me that they were their friend, and I was like,
don't have
I
time
know
for this.
You. So it was just too confusing, you know. I'm just not on social media yet. Yeah. Although I'm supposed to, I think that's going to change because this gaming company be involved, but I have to be involved in a way that doesn't drive me crazy because I also write, I direct shows, I can't be sucking up my time with
social media,
five word answers to stuff. Okay, next.
I'll send my nickel.
So I was wondering, what was the most important thing you learned about MLP, either from the show or from the torrent of fans following it?
What is the most important thing that I learned about My Little Pony from?
Well, learned
from both the
from.
Show and the fans. Is that
either,
the question?
Either or?
Was that the question? Yeah.
Yes.
Okay. Don't read a book by its cover.
Yeah.
What I find to be very interesting about this community is that it's not necessarily what it seems like right off the bat. And I was really drawn to that. I was drawn to it. I just love the notion that somebody is going to have, a guy with a beard is going to have painted fingernails. And you're going to go, and then I go, no, this is a whole new, this is a middle world that you don't know about. And that's actually the reason that we ended up doing the documentary, because, the news programs were being, really ridiculous.
Yeah.
So that's why. Mm,
Fox.
Okay, next.
Greg Gutfeld.
Okay, John, why is your work as Q Discord and just really you as yourself so awesome?
That's very sweet for you to say that. But probably the answer, the takeaway answer that you could apply to anything that you do is that if you bring yourself to the work, that's the first step towards making something special. So, bring yourself to it. And sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. Believe me, there I have a whole slew of things that I did and didn't work out. I mean, I don't mean work out in terms of successfully. I'm just talking about they didn't work out because I just didn't bring myself to it in the right way. So you have to bring yourself to it, which usually has to do with just being honest.
Okay, first off, huge honor to meet you. Have you ever gotten any negative backlash from being on this show? If so, what was your reaction to it, and what advice do you have to people who have gotten backlash from liking My Little Pony?
Well, I think that's what the documentary is about. And I haven't, people are not gonna necessarily come up to me and say, because you're on My Little Pony, you're gonna get negative backlash. I don't really care.
Yeah.
I am able to explain to people you're going to have an opportunity here with Nick that you won't have again. So just organize your thoughts perhaps with the document. One of the things was that I brought people who were my friends, who are our friends, my wife and my friends, to see the documentary at the house after it was finished. We have a little room that's like a little TV room, so you could get six or seven people in there. I would say, please come and see the documentary. It comes with a complimentary dinner.
Delicious dinner.
And I'd love for you, I'd love to hear your thoughts. Well, they're hearing right off the bat what everybody else is saying. So they say, oh, yeah, John, we've been working. We've been hearing about this documentary. It's about, 25-year-old guys watching a woman. So they're already coming with all of this stuff. And I'd like to say that these people, my friends, are quite smart and think of themselves quite progressive. And it was really interesting. They thought that they were going to watch a journey of different characters on the screen. And we did this three times, and three times we got the same response. It wasn't the journey on the screen, it was their journey. Afterwards they went, wow, I was so, I took a trip there. I was like, yeah, no, and yeah, I can see it, and oh my God. And it really made me think about where I am in all of this. So in that respect, I think that we did really well. Okay, yes.
Which one is working? Okay. I wanted to ask you what your favorite Shakespeare play was that you did, and if you have any advice for upcoming theater actors.
What was the favorite play that I did?
Yeah.
Oh, favorite Shakespeare.
Mm-hmm.
Well, the one Shakespeare, my favorite Shakespeare are the Henry IVs, Part 1 and 2. Unfortunately, I never played. I did Romeo twice. Believe me, playing Romeo is a thankless role. Yeah. The minute Mercutio leaves the stage, everybody's like, oh, God. I played Hamlet a couple of times. I'm not sure if Hamlet is even my type of character. I'm not Mr. Poopy. kind of like, come on, just make a decision. So I had big attitudinal problems about that. What is my advice to you as an actress? Is that what you're saying?
Mm-hmm.
I can't really see you that well, but how old are you?
15. I'm a freshman in high school.
Okay. Well, my advice to you is this. It's the same advice that was given to all of us at Juilliard and by John Houseman. Read. And particularly, read Dickens. Mm-hmm. Okay? The level of character development in Dickens is overwhelming. I was sobbing during the scene where, I don't remember the characters' names, but in A Tale of Two Cities, where she meets her father, who she hasn't seen in so many years in prison. I mean, I was just like, you know, reading through things, it will help you tremendously. Great Expectations, the hurt that he goes through, that Pip goes through, and you know, and on and on and on. The other thing that I recommend is that you're at school, you're 15, and they must have plays. Well, do them. And it doesn't really matter, frankly, what the role is. I mean, it's obviously the bigger the role, the more difficult it is. But do them, and then be part of the wardrobe, and be part of props, and be part of, well, I'll direct the scene, and I'll clean up afterwards. Just jump into that world, because being in a play and being in that community is something which is very different than a lot of things. We were talking about this not too long ago. Most people are in jobs that sort of last forever. And therefore, they're in jobs that the personalities that they're working with are very important to them. We don't work that way. What's the most important thing is getting the show on. The show must go on. So you park your personality at the door. You are on best behavior, and you do your work the best that you can. So that's something that's really, even if you don't become an actress, a professional actress, that's something that you can take on to the rest of your life. And the other thing is that if there are two plays a year, remember, you can do little plays, you know, that are 10 pages long, you can do them yourselves. You go to your friends and you say, here, you play this part, you play this part, and we'll continue to do that. So you can continually be working. Okay, thanks.
Thank you so much.
Over here, since we last met, which was Emerald City last year, I was actually cosplaying as a Pokemon, and at the autograph table, it was one question already got out of the way. So I will go to my next one, which was, who do you think Discord should be with, Fluttershy or Celestia?
Oh! He's asking you which of the ponies you would like to date, Fluttershy or Celestia. Oh,
Celestia. If she'll have
it. Okay, next.
Yeah, let's move on.
Okay, next.
Oh, hello, John. This is about you working.
Now, you know what? Why don't you just ask me the question? Because it's really sort of weird to ask somebody a question like this.
Okay.
And I get it all the time. Just try it. Go and talk to your friends with a camera. Okay, go ahead.
John, for the media, is there a film that you'd like to work in? And maybe is there an actor you know that you'd like to work with on Ponies?
Oh, well, again, I've done five. I do it alone in a little recording studio down there, so we don't get to interact whatsoever. So they all seem very nice, and I would like to work with them, but I don't know them. And Is there a film that I would like to be in or something like that?
Yeah, like, is there any kind of film that you would like to be in? Like action?
Well, I saw Mad Max a couple of nights ago, and it was really good. That's it. I mean, yeah, sure. I mean, I'd like to be in all sorts of films, but, you know. Okay, next.
What was your most challenging role? Anything. My Little Pony, Star Trek?
The most challenging role I did was Man and Superman, which is George Bernard Shaw's play, because we did Man and Superman and the Don Juan section. So it's about, now you're talking to somebody who has difficulty memorizing lines because of, you know, the reading and blah, blah, blah. It's 3 hours and 45 minutes on stage.
Dang.
And I started learning it a month beforehand, and I would wake up many, many nights with cold sweats, thinking, I can't do this. I just can't do this. But I did it. And so that was great, and I had a great time doing it.
Thank you.
Okay, first I just want to say, go back to thy own solar system or thou wilt most certainly die.
And then,
my question was, if you could take a character from Star Trek and turn them into a My Little Pony, who would you do and why?
Oh, wow. Spock?
Yeah, I think Spock.
Yeah.
That'd be fun to see.
He already has the ears.
Kirk.
So you go to a lot of conventions as a guest, and you do panels like this. Do you ever go to conventions or festivals just as an attendee?
No.
Yeah, but you know, it's for listening to how man overboard of equipment works, or how to get your diesel to, you know, work when you know you've got to take the injectors out,
yeah.
On and on and on and on. So I also grew up in the, as I said, in the music world, and I created a number of shows for symphony orchestras. So I would go. I do that fairly, but I don't know. It's a little bit of a busman's holiday. I think that should have had a huge applause.
Okay.
Yeah, you are laying down on the drum here, guys.
Howdy. So, considering you are, sorry, I'm a little nervous here. So what's your relationship with the other voice actors, voice actresses? What's it like with the My Little Pony cast? What's your relationship?
Well, I sort of answered that before. When I do it, I am alone. It isn't because I have BO or something like that. I'm alone in the studio, okay? And I'm only reading my part. I mean, I'm only voicing my part. I'm reading the scenes. I've done my homework. So I only really get to meet them here.
Okay.
All right.
Well, thank you so much.
Do you think playing Q for so long helped you play Discord?
My whole life has been a preparation for Discord.
My second question is, who is more Who's more fun to heckle? The Star Trek crew or the ponies? Which of you had more fun playing?
Well, I mean, because the Star Trek crew was actually, like, there.
Right?
They were probably a little more fun.
I'd say a lot more given their reactions.
Alright, so I have two questions. The second one's really quick. My first question is, do you in Discord connect? Like, do you feel like you can connect to your character?
Well, yes, I do. I mean, that goes back to the answer in a somewhat straightforward way with how do you make work your own, and when you do make it your own, it usually makes it better. So yes, I can. I mean, I thought that just going back to the episode just about, you know, jealousy with friends and what have you, I don't have to make that up. I don't have to imagine what somebody else would feel. I have, like all of us in the room, I've had experiences like that, and so I just have to draw on it. I mean, one of the differences between what I do and what you do is that most laymen think of themselves as one person. And actors think of themselves as being made up of many, 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 many different people. So while I'm not a serial killer, I've played, like last night I was explaining, I played a character of a Nazi, who'd be a Nazi war criminal. And I had to find that part of myself that could be like that person. And, you know, thankfully it might be the size of a pea, but then you find it and you begin to grow it and you begin to understand it. You go, I could see how this could happen because you're not creating a new person each time. You're just going, well, there's a part of me that could be like that. So the same thing. I mean, I don't think Discord as being truly a whatever dragon type character. I think of it as being me. Okay.
And my second question is, would you like a piece of fried Scootaloo?
Ah!
No, I'll leave you to. Yeah. I'll leave the salmonella on the other side. Okay, next. We are running. We've got a few more questions. Okay.
Okay. So a while back, back when The Next Generation was still airing, I remember you had said during a. Interview that a man had approached you with a syringe and asked if you would like to have your blood drawn, and it had happened more than once, and I just wanted to know what happened to him.
What?
Huh?
I don't have any, that's an urban myth. And I don't think you got that from me. It might be this, which did actually take place. Years ago, I went to a convention and literally had the flu. So I was really sick, but I had made it, it was an obligation and I fulfilled it. And I was drinking some water and I put it down. And I walked, thank you very much, and I walked off, and a guy jumped up and he grabbed my glass and he goes, I now have the Q virus.
Oh my god.
Wow.
I also had an experience where I'm walking down the street. I mean, those of you who are Trek fans, you know that, but those who don't, I mean, I can tell the story. Hopefully a few of you have not heard it. I'm walking down the street in New York, and and you know, it's twilight and I'm in an okay area, but still you keep your eyes open and what have you. And the blocks are sort of short. And I stepped up onto the block and I saw coming towards me, and the blocks are actually not much longer than the length of this room. I saw a guy coming towards me who looked really unsavory. I mean, like, you know, my eyes went, ooh, wow. So I'm walking, and as we're getting closer, I see that he all of a sudden locks into my eyes. So I walk a little this way, and he adjusts. And we still are walking towards each other. And then I walk this way, and he adjusts, and he gets up right to me. And he's about this big. And I'm pretty big, so he's about this big. By this time, I have my hands out of my pocket, my knees are bent a little bit, and I'm thinking, I'm gonna get mugged. And he gets in really close. And he says, are you Q?
Oh my.
I went, yeah. Can you bring people back from the dead? And I said, only people I like. And he went, cool. And he walked off. That was like,
yeah. Okay, next.
Yes. This is it. Question. What's that?
It's Portuguese.
I didn't hear it.
Bom dia, senhor Delancey.
We can't hear it. Talk.
Okay.
Speak English.
Okay, all right. So, I'm sorry. I'm very nervous. Okay, so, all right. So, here's a question I have. So, a lot of people, I've noticed a lot of people both, okay, so I hear a lot of people both fans and anti-fans and even people who are kind of neutral tend to have this attitude of that a lot of people that once the show ends, the fandom will cease to exist. And I feel like it's kind of a fatalistic and nihilistic attitude to have kind of all of our accomplishments when we kind of render meaningless, or in a best case scenario, will leave somewhat of an impact. How do you feel about this?
Okay, I think I have the dates right, Star Trek, 1965 to 1968, was that?
Wow.
Right? Yeah.
Did the fandom stop?
No.
The reruns, as a matter of fact, there were two major resurgences for Star Trek, which I found to be very interesting. One is the advent of cable television. They needed content, so they put Star Trek back on. But the most important one was a woman by the name of Vigo Trimble. Do you know who she is? She was a fan of Star Trek. And I dare say, I know it's hard to believe in 2015, but back in 1965, if you were a woman and you were interested in Star Trek, there was something wrong with you. There was a deviancy. Yeah, just like the Bronies, which is what attracted me. She wrote when Star Trek looked like it was going to get canceled after its second year, she wrote that to this day, because now nobody uses mail, she wrote to this day, it still ranks as the biggest mail-in campaign. 1 million letters
Oh my
she
God.
Was able to get people to you know, she organized all of that, and they put Star Trek back on the, you know, for another year. My sense is that it doesn't really, you don't really need new shows to, you know, this is episode, you know, 110 and it's the end. The balloon is going to collapse. I don't think so. I just don't think so. As a matter of fact, I think it's just going to keep on growing, and it's really great. Okay, next.
Hi, I'm all hyped up on pre-workout. I was wondering if you wanted to go to the gym later to pump some iron or something. Please?
Do you want to work out with him?
Please.
Yeah, not today. I've already worked out. Okay. Next.
Yes, hello. I have a question. Do you have a favorite line from the episode Make New Friends But Keep Discord?
No.
No, but you have a favorite line. What's your favorite line?
It's when Discord is really angry and he yells at Treehugger telling something about Skoshes.
And what's the line?
Oh, Skosh. A Skosh.
My fire.
It's just Discord yelling, I forgot.
It's a Skosh.
Okay. All right, next.
I just wanted to know, what was going on in your head when you filmed Twilight's Kingdom 1 and 2?
What was going on in my head?
Yeah, what was going on?
When I filmed it? I didn't film it.
Yeah, when you were doing Twilight's Kingdom 1 and 2.
That's too specific for him, too.
Yeah.
The T-Rex episode.
I don't know. I don't know. I don't know. It's way too long ago. I don't know. I mean, it is a very disembodied sort of experience to be doing those things. You are in a room. You're not talking to anyone. There is a speaker on the wall, which you are being listened to by people who are 1,800 miles away, and you're moving really fast. I don't know. I mean, you know, I just finished a play which I performed for 3 months, the same scenes for 3 months. I could talk, you know, ad nauseum about what was going on in those scenes. But when you're doing something for which you have only put in about 4 hours of work, it just doesn't stick in the same way that other projects do. Okay, I'm gonna say one more. Oh, you got it. Yeah, one more question. It's all on you. It's
in your
all
hopes.
On you. No pressure, but it has to be close to the best question. And you want to take it? You want? Okay. All right. Go ahead.
If Discord were to be smitten with love with any character, who would it be?
Oh!
If I were a beast, is that the question? We couldn't hear. We don't have any microphones up or speakers up here.
If Discord were to be smitten with love with any character, who would it be?
Well, I already told you.
Celestia. Woo! My friend said.
But I am by bestial.
By bestial.
I'm quadra bestial. All right, one more.
So I have two questions.
Oh, just give me one question. All right, then
I'll skip to the second one.
Okay.
Who are some of your inspirations for getting into acting?
Inspirations for, well, the biggest inspiration was that I was, as I said before, I was actually, for the first time, not flunking, and somebody thought I was good at it. I was also a huge monster sci-fi fan. So I, my first book that I read when I was, by that time, 12, but it was my first book, was Mysterious Island by Jules Verne. I then began reading the H.G. Wells. I went through all of the movies. And I loved, I just loved a lot of, you know, the Vincent Price and Clifton Webb, and, you know, I mean, it's these old-time actors that you don't know, probably. But I went to all of the science fiction movies and what have you, and I just thought, boy, I'd love to do that. It was interesting to me in terms of what you discover, and that is that it was a number of years after I had made an impact in Star Trek that people said, you know, you have made a real impact in sci-fi. I went, I really? And I just had a real difference between television sci-fi and the movies that I used to go to. In any case, I'm going to be signing, we didn't get to all of you, and I'm really sorry about that. We will try to get to everybody. Please come by. They've put in some extra time, so I will do that. And it's just great being here, and thank you very much.